I want to get in touch with our dear brother, David Wood. David, are you there? Are you with us?
I think so.
Praise the Lord. David, I'm so glad that you're able to be with us today. And have you been able to listen to Brother Al Rasooli and myself in the first part of our program?
I was out getting some medicine for my kids, so I missed most of it.
Brother Al Rasooli and I pointed out, there is so much, not only in the Hadith, which as we looked at with Al-Tabari, we found that he brought out that in the Hadith, basically Muhammad, as you pointed out before, believed that the earth was riding on a big fish and all of these things, and that the sun wears clothes, and the clothes are longer in the summer, and the clothes are shorter in the winter, but also in the Quran, the sun sets in a murky spring. Shooting stars are missiles that God shoots against Satan. There are seven earths and there are seven heavens. Is there anything else you want to bring out about the many verses or the many points in Islam that Yusuf Estes failed to bring out to prove that the whole claim that Islam is scientific is utterly ridiculous?
Well, you're absolutely correct. The verses that Muslims appeal to as miraculous science are nothing of the kind. So on the passage which says that, you know, hey, you have salty water and you have fresh water, and the Quran says there's a barrier between. So on the one hand, if you focus on the salt water and the fresh water, that's something everyone knows, especially a traveler like Muhammad. Anyone in Mecca or Medina would have known this. So that's common knowledge. The only thing that you could say wouldn't have been common knowledge is that there's a barrier in between, and that's just false. There is no barrier. The one dumps into the other, and in that area, there's a mixture. And then the farther you get out to sea, the more salty the content. So the only thing that could be considered not common knowledge is wrong. It's false. But this is nothing compared to the clearly false scientific claims of the Quran and of the Hadith. Whether we turn to astronomy, the structure of the universe, the history of the universe, whether we turn to human reproduction, hygiene, personal hygiene, the spread of disease, everything is wrong. And so we find only two categories when we examine the Muslim sources. If Muhammad gets it right, it's because it was common knowledge that any person on the planet would have known. If he says something that was not common knowledge, he gets it wrong without fail. He's always wrong. And so that's why it's so shocking for Muslims to say, here's our evidence. I mean, we've talked on previous programs. If you look at the Muslim sources, first of all, the mention of the fish, that doesn't just come from the Hadith. That's in the Quran, Surah 68, verse 1. It says nun, which Muslims today will try to translate as pen or inkwell or something like that. But if you go to the early Islamic commentators, you find when they heard this from Muhammad, they were convinced that it was referring to the giant fish that's underneath everything. Let me read you Tafsir of Ibn Abbas. Allah swears by the nun. This is Ibn Abbas's commentary on Surah 68:1. This is Muhammad's companion. You Muslims are supposed to listen to Muhammad's companions and not go with your own interpretations. Ibn Abbas says, Allah swears by the nun, which is the whale that carries the earths on its back while in water, and beneath which is the bull, and under the bull is the rock, and under the rock is the dust, and none knows what is under the dust save Allah. So here you have, in the Quran, Muhammad's companions understood this passage to be talking about a giant fish that holds the earth, holds the seven earths up on its back. And actually, according to the Quran and the Muslim sources, this is why there are earthquakes. Sometimes that fish becomes agitated and he starts wriggling around. And so that's where, and according to the Quran, this is why Allah sent down mountains as tent pegs to hold the earth in place while this fish is moving around. Now, how in the name of common sense can Muslims look at that and say, here's how we know that Islam is true? If you put all the passages together, here's what you have. You have a giant fish down at the bottom of the earths. You have seven earths stacked on top of each other. They're all flat. They're stacked up like pancakes. Out on the side of the top earth, that we're on the top earth, out on the side of the top earth, you have 180 pools. The sun goes down into a different pool each day for a period of 180 days, each one of these murky pools. And on top of that, you have the stars in the lowest heaven, which are missiles that God uses to shoot demons. On top of that, you have seven domes, and these domes, it's important to note, these domes are solid structures. Allah has to hold them up, otherwise they'll fall on the earth. Above the seventh heaven, you have eight giant donkeys that are holding up the throne of Allah. Now, what in that picture is right? What did Muhammad get right? Well, other than the fact that there is a sun and that there is a moon and there are such things as stars, everything Muhammad said was wrong. So once again, the only thing Muhammad gets right are things that everyone knew. There's a sun, there's a star, there are stars, things like that. When Muhammad tries to describe things that people didn't know, he gets every single detail wrong. And this is the same thing whether we turn to astronomy, the history of the universe, whether we turn to biology, human reproduction, the spread of disease, everything is wrong in the Muslim sources.
Mm-hmm. Well, I have to contradict you, David, on one thing. I think out of Muhammad's cosmology, you forgot to include, there's a billy goat. There's a goat somewhere up in the heaven, isn't there?
It's the eight goats. It's the eight goats. There are eight of them.
Eight goats. And didn't we conclude in a previous program that one of those goats was actually the one that ate part of that surah that Aisha lost?
Could be. Now think about this. Because each one of these goats is as tall as one of the heavens. Mm. According to the Quran, the lowest heaven is the heaven that contains all the stars and galaxies. So think about how big our universe is. As massive as our universe is, that's the size of just the first heaven. Mm. So as big as our universe is, that's just the first heaven. And you go up through seven heavens, and each one of these giant goats is as tall as one of the universes.
Amazing.
So, one of these goats is as big as our universe. There are eight of them, and that's where the throne of God is. I mean, if you think about it, this is absolute silly nonsense. If you sat down and tried to come up with a more absurd view of the universe, you couldn't do it. You couldn't come up with something more flawed, more absurd, more ridiculous in every possible way than Muhammad's view of the universe. And this is what Muslims point to as their best evidence that Islam is true.
Mm. Thank you, Brother David. Excellent bringing out of the Quran, the Hadith, and what is spoken there. I understand we have some callers, so I'd like to take those now and allow you and myself to speak to the questions, comments of our dear callers. So why don't we take our first caller right now? We'd like to welcome to our program, Jesus or Muhammad. You're on the air.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Go right ahead.
Hi, this is John Baker. I am a member of the CARM organization. I know you had my pastor on your show recently.
Oh, you poor guy.
Yes, yes.
And I'm a budding apologist to the Muslims. And there's a question they posed for me.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm glad you have David Wood on.
Yes.
He can help. Can answer. They often ask me about 1 Samuel 16:2, and they seem to think that this means that God is a liar, which, of course, we as Christians deny. Our Father does not lie. He does not condone lying.
1 Samuel 16:2. Let's read it for our sake and for viewers' sake as well. 1 Samuel 16:1. Let's read 1. Now the Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you mourn for Saul?" Is this the passage that you're talking about?
Yes, it is.
"How long will you mourn for Saul, seeing I have rejected him from reigning over Israel? Fill your horn with oil and go. I am sending you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided myself a king among his sons." And Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears it, he will kill me." But the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Then invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do. You shall anoint for me the one I name to you." Now, for me, I'm just going to take a 20-second answer, and then I'm going to go to David Wood, because David knows better than me, and he's a debater. But my immediate response would be that he did go and sacrifice. And so here is not a particular lie that God is commanding them. He's saying, go. The Lord says, tell him, take a heifer with you and say, I've come to sacrifice to the Lord. And he does go and sacrifice, doesn't he?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so that's my understanding. Brother David, do you have some more to share there? How would you respond to this in a debate?
Well, I just say the same thing that you said. Samuel is worried that Saul is going to kill him if he goes to anoint someone. And God says, well, perform a sacrifice. Go on your way to perform a sacrifice, and Saul won't kill you. So I don't see this as in any way deceptive. As you pointed out, God sends him to perform a sacrifice, and he does perform the sacrifice. At the same time, I would point out how absolutely desperate it is of Muslims to point to things like this when their sources are filled with direct deception. If you ask a Muslim what happened at the crucifixion of Jesus, they'll tell you Jesus wasn't crucified. Instead, Allah tricked everyone into believing that he was crucified. Allah replaced Jesus on the cross with someone like Judas, made everyone think that Jesus was crucified when he really wasn't, and so deceived all kinds of people. You know, Pastor Joseph, that according to the Quran, Allah is the greatest of deceivers. He's the greatest of mockers.
Yes.
So according to the Quran, Allah, now keep in mind, you know, in Christianity, Satan is the father of lies. In Islam, Allah is the greatest of deceivers. This is not according to us. This is according to the Quran. You have Abu Bakr in the Muslim sources saying that if he had one foot in paradise, he would still fear Allah's deception. He is so scared that Allah is of Allah as being deceptive, that if Allah let him get halfway into paradise, he'd still be worried that Allah is just tricking him and going to send him to hell. And this is one of the greatest Muslims. This is Muhammad's closest companion, closest friend on earth. And he was terrified of Allah's deception. Not only that, you have in the Muslim sources that Muslims are allowed to deceive people left and right. That's called taqiyya. They're allowed to deceive people. They're allowed to deceive fellow Muslims. If a Muslim man and a Muslim woman are having a fight over something, Muslims are allowed to deceive them in order to reconcile them. So if a husband and wife are disputing, and through lies and manipulation and deception, you can reconcile them, you're allowed to do that in Islam. It's much more serious when it comes to war, because Muslims are allowed to deceive people in war, but their definition of war is much broader, much more broad than our definition of war. They believe that they're at war with all unbelievers, not in a physical war, but they believe that they're at war with us. We're the house of war. Our entire country, the West, it's all the house of war. They believe they're at war with us, which is why they believe that they're allowed to deceive us. And this is according to the Muslim sources. If you go to Surah 3, verse 28, you'll read that Muslims are not to be friends with unbelievers. Well, you may ask yourself, why are so many Muslims in the West friends with unbelievers? Well, they're told in that same verse, if you're outnumbered, if you're threatened by a stronger adversary, you can pretend to be friends with them in order to guard yourselves against them. And when we go to the Muslim sources, when we go to Ibn Kathir, we find Ibn Kathir saying that Muslims are allowed to show friendship outwardly if they feel threatened by a stronger adversary, if they're in a country where they're outnumbered. They're allowed to pretend to be friends outwardly, but never inwardly. Inwardly, they have to hate the unbelievers and to long for the day when they will conquer us. Ibn Kathir goes on to quote Muhammad's companion Abu Darda, who, commenting on this Muslim view, says, "We smile in the face of some people, although our hearts curse them." So even though inwardly they're cursing us, they're smiling in our faces, making us think that they're friendly. So in Islam, you have a God who is a deceiver. In fact, he's the greatest of deceivers. Even devout Muslims are to be afraid and fear the deception of this being. You have him starting false religions, according to Islam, keep in mind. Paul didn't start Christianity. Well, he didn't start the belief in Jesus' death. Allah started that belief. Allah tricked people into believing that Jesus died on the cross. So Allah is responsible for the belief of billions of Christians that Jesus died on the cross. Allah started that in order to trick them. And notice, even Jesus' followers, who according to the Muslim sources were good Muslims, even Jesus' followers were deceived by this. So now you have people who are following, according to Islam, who are agreeing to follow a prophet, and God even deceives them. You can see why someone like Abu Bakr would have been absolutely terrified. Even if you follow God's prophets, Allah still might deceive you. He still might trick you into believing all sorts of false things.
Thank you, Brother David. Excellent. Let me cut you off there for that excellent response and ask, is our viewer still with us, our caller?
Hi. Yes, I am.
Yes. Has that helped you, this explanation by Brother David?
Oh, yes. The explanation was wonderful. I just want to say in closing that the reason I watch your show is because I like to learn about Islam from people from that culture.
Yes.
And this is what I get at ABN, and I think that's wonderful.
Well, I'm so glad that you do watch our program, and I just want to say, brother, as an apologist, budding or not, we're all budding to a certain extent and getting better and better with God's help. You know, I would emphasize something. Muslims always like to get into these nitty-gritty arguments, but from what Brother David has said, my response would be, what are you trying to prove? Are you trying to prove that the God of the Bible is a God who teaches us to lie and deceive? And get them to answer. And if they say, well, yes, then you say, oh, so then you're trying to tell me that the God of the Bible is the same God of the Quran, which teaches your prophet and yourself to lie and deceive. Is that correct? You see how you turn it back upon them. Because Muslims, of course, as you know, are famous for any time we bring a question to them, they immediately try to redirect things and go back to attack us. Of course, we're not hiding anything. We should give them a good answer, just as Brother David gave an excellent answer. But the point that he brought out is to say, hey, wait a minute, are you saying that there's something wrong with God lying? Of course, we believe that there is, and you can bring that out. But at the same time, take that opportunity to say, do you think it's okay for God to lie and for him to teach lies? And see what they say. And if they say, well, no, of course not, then take them, for example, to Surah 8:30 and other passages in the Quran which say that Allah is the Khair al-Makhirin, which they've translated Yusuf Ali, the best of planners, but if you look at other translations, it's the best of deceivers, and there's actually an old fable or a saying in Arabic, and it says, Makhir mithil thalib. What does that mean? That means deceptive like a fox. That's the understanding of the word makhir in Arabic. So thank you so much, brother, for calling and watching our programs. Please continue to watch and pray for us.
God bless.
God bless you. Thank you, dear Brother John.
Pastor Joseph.
Yes, go right ahead, David.
I just wanted to give a quick reference for our brother, something he could look up to learn more about this issue and for any of our other viewers. If you go to the Answering Islam website, so www.answering-islam.org, answering-islam.org, there's a menu on the side, and if you go to the link that says Index to Islam, so there's a link that says Index to Islam on the side, if you click on the index, then there's an alphabet of entries, and you go to deception, look up the word under D, deception, and you'll have plenty of resources there on lying and deception from Allah and encouraged in the Quran.
Very good. And Brother David, could you quickly comment? I know we have callers waiting. I ask you all to be patient with us. We'll get to you in just a moment. But Brother David, can you comment on this thought that I brought up, that Muslims love to take us in roundabout arguments into minutiae of issues when oftentimes as apologists and as Christians, we need to keep hold our eyes on the big picture. And it seems like Muslims love to take our eyes off of that. Can you give any comments or suggestions on that?
Well, yeah, that's crucial, and that's really foundational to Islamic apologetics. They have these massive problems, and so if you're stuck with massive problems in your religion that you can't defend, you have to turn people's attention towards other issues, and so it's essential to stick to an issue. If you bring up an issue, hey, why is Islam, why is deception encouraged in Islam? if a Muslim tries to change the subject, say, look, I'd be happy to talk about that after we finish this discussion, after you've addressed this point and given a clear answer on this, then we can move on to that other point. Be happy to talk about it. But right now we're talking about this. It seems you're trying to change the subject. Why would you be trying to change the subject? If your religion is true, why can't you answer the question?
Excellent. Excellent. Very good. And also, I would remind our Christian brothers and sisters, when a Muslim ever asks you to quote a verse from your Bible, be ready, because they're simply having you to quote a verse out of context for them to prove something. My suggestion is to ask him, tell me what you want to prove, and then take me to the verse to explain it. But you'll find that Muslims are reticent to do this because they want to give shock value, ripping a verse out of context to try to take you off guard. So
yes, start at the beginning of the chapter.
Absolutely. Yep. Sometimes the beginning of the book, but yeah, usually the beginning of the chapter, you're okay, right?
Yeah, a lot of the time, the verse before or the verse after totally refutes what the Muslims are trying to say.
Absolutely. That's an excellent suggestion and advice to apologists, Christian apologists, almost all the time. Almost all the time. Not almost all the time. All the time. Whenever there's an issue, if you read it in the context, it will be resolved. Well, on that note, let's go back to our callers who've been patiently waiting. I'd like to take the next caller right now. Welcome, you're on the air with Jesus or Muhammad.
Hello, Pastor Joseph and David Wood. This is Manu.
Hey, Manu.
Hello.
Welcome.
I was watching the program, the first part with IQ Rasuli.
Yes.
And I wish he was still on so I could ask him, but the part about the sun setting in the murky water.
Yes.
If you read the passage, is that it's talking about Zulkarnain is going and taking different routes, and he says goes to a people and he finds them, you know, and then that's where he sees that it's from his perspective that the sun is setting in a murky water or a murky pool.
Okay.
So that is not the Islamic teaching of or Muhammad's understanding that the sun would set in a giant pool.
Okay, Manu, so just one second. You said that it seemed from his perspective that it was setting in a murky pool. It's Surah 18, verse 86. Now, you know I know enough Arabic to be dangerous, and so do you. So show me in the verse where it says, from his perspective, it seemed. Show me that language in the verse, Manu.
Okay, it says, وَجَرَهَا تَقْرُبُ فِي عَيْنٍ حَمَئَةٍ وَجَرَهَا and found it.
وَجَرَهَا and found. Yeah.
Not it appeared to him as some kind of illusion. He found
right.
it. That's what he found.
That's the verse, Manu. You would agree. It doesn't say in the verse, it appeared to him. وَجَرَهَا is found. It's a simple verb to find. So who's
walking about? Zulkarnain. He says he's going different routes. You know, he says the verse before it. He says we've given him from everything, and then he says sababa sababan.
Okay, let's look at the verse, Manu, in Arabic, and we'll do the best we can from the beginning. Hatta idh iblag maghrab al-shams wajaddaha, okay, al-shams, that's the sun, wajaddaha, and he found it, tagrabu fi ayn hamma'a wa wajadda inda haqquma, okay, so,
yes.
And he, the sun, he found it, right? He found it tagrabu fi ayn hama wa wajada. He found it set in a spring of murky water.
And Pastor Joseph,
what is the verse saying is that before he took a route. Ba'ataba sababan. So he first took a route and then he says till he came to a place that he found the sun
yes.
setting in a murky pool, and then he says, and then he found near that, or in front of it, or before it, a group of people.
Okay, agree with you. That's exactly what the verse says. We agree with you. Yusuf Ali agrees with you. The best understanding we have of the Arabic agrees with you. In that verse, there is no sense of it appeared to him, it seemed like. That is something that you and other Muslims have added in based on your belief in science that the sun does not, in fact, set in a murky pool of water. Let's go to David Wood, and then you can bring back your answer. David Wood, anything to say here?
Yes, Pastor Joseph. I'd like to point out that even in this verse, the problem is not simply with this phrase, he found it setting in a spring of murky water. If you go to the earlier part of the verse, when it says, till when he reached the setting place of the sun. Where is there a place where the sun sets? The earth is round. You can go as far west as you want. You'll eventually just go around the world. You never reach a place where the sun sets. So it's simply false to refer to a setting place of the sun. So according to this verse, Alexander the Great, Dhul Qarnayn, traveled so far west, he kept going so far, he actually reached the setting place of the sun. What did he find? Now keep in mind, if someone wants to say it just appeared to him, so he saw it reflect, he saw the sun reflecting off a lake or something like that, well, that's not the setting place of the sun. You'd never reach the setting place of the sun. So on the one hand, you have the problem of this passage saying that there is a setting place of the sun, a place that you can actually reach, and then on the other hand, you have it saying that he found the sun going down into this place. So he found it going down. The place where the sun actually sets is a spring of murky water. So two massive errors, not just one. There are two. And if you want to say it means something else, there are a number of problems you have to deal with. One, why is the Quran so unclear over and over and over again? The Quran claims to be clear. And here it really sounds like it's saying there's a place where the sun sets, you can reach it, and you'll find that the sun sets in a spring of murky water. Beyond this, we have commentaries. I know our friend Manu doesn't like the commentaries and doesn't like the hadith and doesn't like the seerah literature, but we have comments from Muhammad's companions on the correct interpretation of this passage. In Al-Zamakhshari, we read this. Abu Dhar, one of Muhammad's companions. This is one of Muhammad's companions. This is not a Muslim who came along 500 years later. This is one of the companions. Abu Dhar was with Muhammad during the sunset. So they're watching the sun go down. Muhammad asked him, "Do you know, O Abu Dhar, where this sun sets?" He answered, "God and his apostle know better." Muhammad said, "It sets in a spring of slimy water." So Muhammad himself says, no, the sun actually goes down into a spring. This is not, he's not talking about this appearing to anyone. He's telling his follower exactly what happens. We find the same thing in At-Tabari. We find the same thing in Al-Baydawi. So think about this. This is what it means according to Muhammad. And by the way, my friend, we also know from sources around the same time that this was a myth. This was a legend during this time. There was a book around the same time called The Glorious Deeds of Alexander, where it said Alexander the Great traveled so far west, he found the place where the sun set. It's a much more detailed account, but this was not a Muslim source. So people during Muhammad's time were saying that Alexander the Great traveled so far west, he found the place where the sun set. The same exact story ends up in the Quran. You have a place where the sun sets, and it's going down into a spring of murky water, two of the same details that are found in this story that was circulating during Muhammad's time. You have, according to the Quran, you can reach this place. You have Muhammad himself commenting on this verse and saying, no, this really does mean that the sun goes down into a spring of murky water. You have the commentaries, you have the sources, everything, every shred of evidence we can put together tells us that Muhammad believed that the sun goes down in a spring of murky water. Modern Muslims, like you, Manu, know that this isn't true, and so you reinterpret it. But that's not what you should do. You shouldn't say, look, Muhammad is clearly saying that the sun sets in a pool of murky water. That's wrong, so let me reinterpret it. Your response should be, hey, Muhammad is telling us, and the Quran is telling us, that the sun sets in a spring of murky water. That's false. He's a false prophet. I reject him. Let me go find another religion.
Thank you, Brother David. I'm going to cut you right there. Manu, the evidence on this verse seems very, very stacked against your favor, not only including the The Arabic itself, which I have in front of me, an etymological breakdown of the Arabic, there's no it would seem, there's no it would appear, as well as Brother David mentioning this book, The Glorious Deeds of Alexander. We know that many Muslims in the past have identified this Zul al-Qarnayn as Alexander, but whether or not he was Alexander the Great, it doesn't matter. Mr. Manu, what is your answer to this? Can't you just say, hey, that's one of those verses that just shouldn't have made it through the cut?
My only answer is that I know you and David Wood and Sam Shamoon, and you know that you use the Islamic sources, the hadith and so forth. However, there is another possibility that you also should consider. For example, if just for 1 second, consider that Quran is from God. Now, if God told Muhammad a verse, maybe Muhammad even at that time could not understand it, but he had to exactly say what was revealed to him. So he would say the revelation. Now, he might not even have understood it to some degree what exactly the right way to look at that verse, or you know, his view of the universe might have been flawed himself. But after he passes away, now, regardless of what his companions would write, based on their understanding, by their knowledge of that at that time, does not make it that their version and their interpretation was the correct one either.
Oh, okay, Manu, I understand that. We agree with you. But now, what then does it mean, without doing injustice to the text itself, what does it mean? It certainly appears, the literal meaning appears, wouldn't you agree? The literal meaning appears like the sun sets in a murky spring of water. Anybody who reads it, who doesn't care about Christianity, doesn't care about Islam, doesn't give a flip about your view or mine, reads this, they're going to think it says the sun sets in a murky spring of water. What do you believe it means?
I believe from his point of view, because it says that he went there, and then he found it. You know what I mean? He found to the point of where the sun is setting, and then he goes and he says he found another group of people in that area. So most likely, the Quran is talking about his journey, that he kept going forward on his way till he reached a very large lake, or possibly even a sea. You know, my understanding is that it could have been even the Caspian Sea or the Black Sea, but it most likely might have been even beyond that, maybe in somewhere in Mongolia or somewhere. And then that's where he finds the people, and that's where, from his perspective, the sun is setting into a big lake.
Okay, Manu, why would this be an important thing to say? Anybody who looks at any body of water anywhere on the earth throughout history would see the sun setting, and it would appear to them as it was setting into the water. Really, what you're telling us is an incredulous exegesis of this passage, Manu.
What I'm telling you is that is the storytelling, and the Quran is saying that to some degree, part, a very key part of his journey. One of the key part of his journey was that he kept going on his way till he reached, like, there was no land. Most likely he reached either an ocean or he reached a very large lake or sea. And that's what he's saying.
David would like to speak, Manu, and then we're going to have to move on for time's sake. Go ahead, David.
Yes. Wouldn't it have been much clearer? Remember, the Quran claims to be clear. If the Quran really is a book that's meant to be clear, wouldn't it have said then, and Zul al-Qarnayn traveled so far west, he reached a giant lake, or he reached the Black Sea, or he reached the ocean, and when he found this ocean, he saw a reflection on the water, and it seemed to him that the sun was going down. But that's not what it says. It doesn't say he went and found a lake, he went and found an ocean. It says he reached the setting place of the sun. And again, there is no such place. There is no place where the sun sets. This verse says there is, and there isn't. If there is, please point me to it. Please show me a place where the sun sets. You won't show it to me because there is none. And then beyond this, it goes even further and says, and he found the sun setting in a murky spring. So it says there is a place. Where is this place? Well, it's that murky spring way out west where the sun goes down into. Again, see, there are only two possibilities here. Either this verse means what it says, either the Quran is clear, and this verse is clearly wrong and it's false, and it's certainly not scientifically accurate, or this verse means something completely different. So when it says setting place of the sun, it means a big lake, even though it doesn't say that. And when it says he found it going down in a murky spring, it really means there was some sort of optical illusion, and it seemed to him that the sun was going down into a murky spring. If that's the case, if the Quran doesn't mean what it says, then the Quran isn't clear. And when the Quran claims to be clear, it's wrong. So either way, the Quran is wrong. Either the Quran is clear, and in this case, it's wrong, or the Quran isn't clear, in which case, it's wrong to say that it's clear. So either way, the Quran is wrong. No reason to believe it.
Thank you, Brother David Wood. Thank you, Manu. We appreciate your words. Of course, we disagree and do not find your case here at all compelling. We hope to hear from you again in future programs. Let's take the next caller right now. Welcome, you're on the air with Jesus or Muhammad. Hello, you're on the air with Jesus or Muhammad.
Hello.
Hello, yeah, welcome.
My name is Suzanne.
Yes, go right ahead, Suzanne.
Hi, how are you? God bless you, David, and protect you.
Thank you so much. God bless you, sister.
Thank you, and increase you in his ministry and service.
Hallelujah.
I wanted also to say the same prayer for Brother Al-Rasuli.
Yes.
I really don't know what's his background and how much he knows about Quran, like where his knowledge came from. I know he knows a lot, but that was my question for him, but I couldn't.
Yeah, well, you can reach IQ Al-Rasuli at his website, www.alrasuli, that is rassoli.com, I believe he said, alrasuli.com. You can reach him there. You can also find an email contact to ask him individually at, let's see, I think he has, you better go with that one for right now, alrasuli.com.
Okay, and what's his book? You mentioned a couple times about
yeah,
his book.
I'll show you that, Lifting the Veil, The True Faces of Muhammad and Islam. And all of this was on YouTube until they accused him of hate speech and have recently taken it off. But Lifting the Veil by IQ Al-Rasuli, R-A-S-S-O-O-L-I. So check that out on the internet.
Okay.
You can buy the book. You can also get his website and email him. And he's very diligent in responding to all emails.
Sure. Thank you. And my I have one comment regarding what was said earlier, that
yes,
how God is the great of deceivers.
Yes.
Khairul Makirin.
Yes.
You know what? I worship the Lord Jesus Christ and thank God for his honesty and his faithfulness. And
Amen.
As it says in 1 John 2, that this is the promise he promised us, is eternal life. And thank him, he's not a deceiver.
Amen.
We have a promise, and he is faithful, and he keeps his promises. And also, like, I'm not trying to mock the Muslim
right.
Friends.
Yeah.
But, you know, when the Lord says in Psalm 103, also he forgives all your sins, that means he does forgive. He's not deceiving us.
Amen.
And I want to say to our Muslim friends, if God is deceiver or even the greatest of deceivers, how even they can believe anything he's written for them?
Great point.
How can they believe the ways he taught them that he can forgive their sins in heaven or in Jannah or wherever.
Absolutely.
Whatever he says, he can even deceive them. Even like Abu Bakr said, if one foot in and the other one is out, he cannot trust God.
That's right. What a terrible religion.
So what
a terrible...
I wanna say,
yeah.
What I want to say, even if both feet are in, God can still deceive him and send him back to hell.
Yeah,
whenever he wants, because he's a deceiver.
That's right. That's
My
right.
heart goes out for them.
Well, continue to pray for them, dear sister. Pray for us. Thank you so much. And if you have any trouble contacting Brother Al Rasuli, email me at newsandviews@abnsat.com, or you can also email Jesus or Muhammad at abnsat.com. Either one, we'll take that up and get you Al Rasuli's information. God bless you, sister. Thanks so much for calling.
Thank you. And bless you, too, and keep you.
Thank you, sister. Bye now. Brother David, any comments before we go to the next caller?
No, let's go on.
Let's take the next caller right now. Welcome, you're on the air with Jesus or Muhammad.
Boss, this is Saleh Yusuf from Los Angeles.
Saleh, I miss you. I'm glad you called. Go right ahead.
Yes, I do miss you too, Pastor Joseph. You know, I want you to listen to me very carefully and David too at the same time.
Yes.
You know, I born as a Christian, as the Lutheran. I'm from the Swedish Lutheran Church. But, you know, I grew up with a Muslim as well as with a Christian. What I'm talking about is the spiritual part of it and the miracle part of it, of being a Christian as well as a Muslim. I don't know anybody who have experienced what I have experienced. You know, as a Christian, I was very devoted to my Lord, and I worship my Lord as any one of you. And then the spiritual part of it, the miracle part of it, is that I come with people who are possessed by a demon, evil eye, as well as witchcraft. Mm. And there is a time I cast a Muslim man from a Christian woman, and I was really shocked because I was believing, you know, as the perfect as a Muslim, and then cast him out, a man from a Christian woman. That was a shock for me. Mm. And then I go, and then I cast the Christian out of a Muslim body. So if you ever experience this, I would like, you know, David or you as the pastor, or as the devoted man, the anointed man, Pastor Joseph, have you ever experienced anything like this? You know, the reason I'm watching your program is if there's something to learn about it, but you always argue the Christians this, the Muslims this, the Muslims this, the Jews this, that. No. What is the spiritual part you have ever experienced? Can you comment on anything about this stuff?
Are you talking about spiritual manifestations, strange things happening, miracles, that type of thing?
Yes. If you clearly hear me what I said, there was a Christian woman who was sick and possessed by an evil man of a Muslim. You know, and I speak to the body, although the woman was sick, she laying down, her eyes is upside down. And the spirit of the other, the evil eye of the Muslim, is speaking on her body. And I cast him out. And he told him his name is Abdullah. I told him he have to leave her in the name of the Lord. He said, I'm going to leave her. I asked him, how are you going to leave?
What name did you use, Saleh? Saleh, did you, what name did you use?
The God, the old God.
Did you say in the name of Jesus?
Yes.
You said, I command you to leave in the name of Jesus.
Yes, so the Muslim, and I was a Muslim too. I was a Muslim when I did this, but I cast him out with the Christ name, with the God name, everything. So the lady was shivering, and, you know, when I asked him, who are you, speak out. And then he said, I am Abdullahi. I was shocked.
So, okay, all right. Brother, let me ask Brother David, first of all, Brother David, would you like to comment on this at all?
I'm not sure I fully understood everything, so I'll let you comment, Pastor Joseph.
Well, it's very interesting. You find in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 7, verse 21 and following, it says, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? And then will I profess unto them, depart from me, ye workers of iniquity, I never knew you. So it's very interesting that Saleh would talk about this. Now, Saleh, as far as I know, you are still a Muslim, are you not?
But my question, how could I do two things at the same time?
Okay, very good. Very, very good. That verse, Saleh, I don't know. I mean, God knows what happened that day. We're receiving your testimony. But the Bible tends to suggest that there will be people who have done works in the name of Jesus that were not truly Christians. However, the Bible teaches that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And the demons tremble at the name of Jesus. When Jesus would go places when he was alive on the earth, the demons would run away, would scream out, "What have we to do with thee, thou Jesus of Nazareth, thou Son of the Most High God? Have you come to torment us before our time?" So the Bible, according to Matthew 7, 21 and following, tends to say that there will actually be people that cast out devils in the name of Jesus who are not true Christians. That's Matthew 7, 21. I know you have a Bible, Saleh. I encourage you to read that. And if you truly did cast out a demon in the name of Jesus Christ, then my God, man, why don't you go ahead and become a Christian all the way? Because there is no name above the name of Jesus Christ. And we give God praise. If that was a true deliverance, it was a deliverance by the power of the name of Jesus Christ. And you know, that's exactly what Peter said when he was questioned in the book of Acts. When he made a lame man well, they asked him, the Jews asked him, what happened? And he says, if you want to know what happened, this man was made well by faith in the name of Jesus Christ. He didn't say, I did it. He didn't say that we did it. He said that faith in the name of Jesus Christ has made this man well. So praise God, Saleh. If what you have told us is a true deliverance, and that's a wonderful miracle, why don't you go ahead and become a Christian and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ?
Pastor Joseph, I have done it for so many years. Still, I could do it. Still, I have done it when people, I see the Christian friend who I have, they need, even if I hold, if I touch, the sick person, and my prayers will help the person. I do it between the Muslim and the Christian. But, it is a gift from the Lord. Could be, I don't know what it is, but the thing is, it does scare me too, because when I do those miracles by the word of God, it scares me because I don't see those who I cast them out, and it is because the person who is sick is really struggling. It's between life and death because the person don't know what's going on with him. And
Saleh, please, what you're doing, assuming that what you're doing is right and what you're telling us is right, in the name of Jesus, Jesus is working miracles by you invoking his name. He is the miracle-working God. As you know, Muhammad didn't do any miracles in the Quran. Jesus is the miracle-working God. What he said is true, and he said in the Bible that he will cast out devils through his servants. Why don't you go ahead and give your heart to Jesus Christ and become a complete Christian, and you will be saved from sin, and will you not be able to do many more mighty and wonderful deeds in the name of Jesus Christ once you give your heart to him?
Pastor Joseph, I could have done that, no problem. But the thing is, I have experience for this thing, this both the Christian and the Muslim. As I said before, I have cut the Christian from the Muslim with Ayatul Kursi and Walillah now is now the name of Allah, the 99 name of Allah. Because the devil within the Christian scared the name of Allah, which is 99 names. And so, where am I? Where am I? Where do I fit? I don't know where I'm fitting, but I do live like this. I have been living like this. I enjoy reading the Bible. All my prayers is based on the Song of David, which I love it. if I want anything to know about God, I go read the letter of Paul. There's nothing he haven't said.
Salah, Brother David and I are very encouraged to hear that you read the Bible and you have questions. Salah, if what you tell us is true, you have done more miracles than Muhammad ever did in his entire prophetic career. You have done more miracles than he did. Give up this Muhammad. Give up this Quran. Give up this Islam. Come to Jesus Christ, the one who raised the dead, the one who healed the sick, who cast out devils, who the devils feared. He healed the lepers. He calmed the storm. And he alone raised from the dead. And Salah, he wants to raise you up by the power of his Holy Spirit and give you eternal life that'll begin right now if you'll simply receive him. Don't you want to pray to receive Jesus Christ right now, Salah?
Pastor Joseph, let me say this to those Muslims who've been saying about love and peace. Let me tell you, all Muslim, you never know what love is. All Muslim, you don't know what peace is. You don't have peace. I don't have peace with you, all Muslims. I have suffered with you. I'm suffering with you, but I'm still a Muslim. I live as a Muslim. I die a Muslim. But you Muslim, you don't know what love is. Learn from the Christian what love is. Learn peace from the Christian. Oh, you Muslim, you liars. You don't know nothing about Christ. You don't know nothing about anything. Have a nice day, Pastor Joseph. David, keep up the struggle.
We love you, Salah. We love you, and we're going to keep praying for you, our dear brother, Salah. In Jesus' name. You too, Salah. Brother David, did you hear that? And now we only have a few minutes left. Would you like to comment on what Salah said? I called him brother because by faith we're going to call him brother, that it's not long, and he will be our brother indeed. Brother David, some closing comments on what Salah said.
Well, Salah seems like a very interesting fellow. And what we can see in Salah is, I mean, how powerful Islam is at keeping people Muslims. Here's a guy who is drawn in every possible way to Christianity through miracles or through love. He loves to read the Bible. He finds strength in the Bible. He loves the Psalms. He likes the letters of Paul. And yet still remains a Muslim. And this is something that is so common in Islam, even if people start to realize Islam is not true. And he was calling on his fellow Muslims, stop this. You need to learn that this is all wrong, and will still remain in Islam. And I just encourage all the Muslims out there who are watching, take heed to what he said. And I encourage everyone, not just to recognize that Islam is false, but to actually abandon this false religion.
Brother David, thank you so much. I understand we have a lot of callers left. I'd like to extend the show, but it's beyond my control today. I would direct our callers to call in Wednesday night at 10:30 p.m. on our News and Views program. And then again, hopefully next week, we'll have this program at the same time. And Brother David, we have really no time left, but can you just, in like 1 minute or less, tell our viewers about the Jesus or Muhammad Marathon?
Yes, next month, I believe, from the 15th through the 21st, June 15th through 21st, we're going to have a marathon of Jesus or Muhammad, not only Pastor Joseph and me and Sam Shamoon, but also James White and Mary Jo Sharp and a couple of others are going to be on the program, a couple of programs in Arabic, most of the programs in English, but we're going to have a ton of programs. We're going to have some debates right there on TV. So it's going to be an action-packed week. We're going to have, I think, two shows every evening. From the 15th through the 21st. So if you have Muslim friends out there and you want to show them that Christianity is true and that Islam is false, this would be a great time. They can sit down and watch. We'll cover all the major topics, and they can call in and ask questions, and we can show them
Thank you.
That Jesus Christ is Lord.
Amen. And can you honor us, David, by closing the show in prayer? We would greatly appreciate it.
Sure, brother. Father, we thank you for the opportunity you've blessed us with to proclaim your word, to proclaim the truth, to refute false teachings in the name of Jesus. We just pray that everyone watching, that Christians will be encouraged, that non-Christians will see that you are the truth, Lord. We pray that Muslims will see the problems in Islam, that they will stop defending this false religion, and that they will embrace you, Lord. We thank you for those who are seeing the truth. We pray for Manu and for Salah, that they will come to know you as we know you, and we give you all the praise and glory. In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name. Thank you, Brother David. God bless you. Thank you, viewers, for watching our program, Jesus or Muhammad. We'll see you.